إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبد الله ورسوله أرسله ربه بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ألا وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. I bear witness that there is none worthy of our worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I bear witness that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the seal of the prophets and the final messenger to all of humanity. Whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, there is none to misguide. And whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves to go astray, there is none to guide aright. Today, inshallah, I'm going to talk about a very important concept in Islam, which is called in Arabic, ulu al-himma, to think big and aim high. And this concept basically means that you always make plans for yourself, something you need to achieve, make goals and plans for the future, and you try always to be a better person. When you look at the hadith and also the Quran and the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba and the great Muslims in Islamic history, they always had ulu al-himma. They were always aiming high and thinking big. You read in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُحِبُّ مَعَالِيَ الْأُمُورِ وَأَشْرَافَهَا وَيَكْرَهُ سَفَاسِفَهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves great and tremendous things, and He doesn't like trivialities, wasting your time in nonsense and small things. The hadith in Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, also there is another hadith in Bukhari. The first one was in Sahih al-Jami'ah, the second one is in Bukhari. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, إِذَا سَأَلْتُمُ اللَّهَ فَسَأَلُوهُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ فَإِنَّهُ أَعْلَى مَنْزِلَةً فِي الْجَنَّةِ. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says in this authentic hadith, when you pray to Allah, ask Him to give you al-Firdaws al-A'la, the highest place in Jannah. Not only Jannah, but the highest place. So don't ask for the basement of Jannah, but ask for the highest place. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you Jannah without punishment, because some people go to Jahannam first for whooping, they get punished for their sins in this dunya, then eventually they will go to Jannah. So always ask Allah to give you Jannah without punishment and to give you the highest place of it. We have a school here, so I was a student one day, I still am. So if you aim at A plus, if you aim high and you miss, you're gonna land somewhere close to the top. But if you aim low and you miss, you will go down a big time. So if you aim at A plus and you miss, you're gonna get A minus or minimum B plus. But if you aim C, you're gonna get an X or a Z, okay? So the same thing for Jannah. When you aim to go to Jannah, aim for the highest place, which is Al-Firdaws al-A'la, because if you miss Al-Firdaws al-A'la, you're gonna get somewhere close to the top. But if you aim at the basement of Jannah and you miss, where are you going? Barbecue. Down. You're going down a big time. So always keep this in your mind. And this is the advice of the Prophet ﷺ in the hadith. If you look at the Prophet ﷺ, his life, he had ulu al-himma. He had a goal and he had a mission and he was trying to achieve it. So every Muslim should have a legacy, something you leave behind. And this is something that will raise your rank in the next life. So if you look at the Prophet ﷺ, just by reading his sunnah and his hadith, his biggest mission and ulu al-himma in life was to make da'wah to Muslims and non-Muslims. He was always making da'wah. So for example, I'm going to give you two situations. The two most difficult situations in somebody's life is when he is dying or when he is under attack. These are the two most difficult situations in your life. So when the Prophet ﷺ was dying, what are the last words that came out of his mouth? As-salatu, as-salatu wa ma malakat aymanukum. Pray, pray, make salat. These were the last words. So the Prophet ﷺ was making da'wah to the last breath in his life. And still a lot of Muslims don't even pray. And the Prophet ﷺ, when he was making hijrah from Mecca to Medina, we know the story, but not a lot of Muslims know that the Prophet ﷺ actually made da'wah to some kuffar on his way to Medina, and they accepted Islam on the spot. Although the people of Mecca were after him, trying to kill him and get the 100 camel ransom. So there are some stories in Sirah that the Prophet ﷺ came across thieves, like two chores, two thieves, on his way to Medina. He made da'wah to them, and he accepted Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ said, what's your name? And they said, people call us the disgraced ones, al-muhanan. So the Prophet ﷺ said, not anymore. Now you are the honored ones. The Prophet ﷺ also, in another narration, came across a man by the name Buraidat al-Aslami and his tribe. They were on the way to Medina, and he made da'wah to them. They accepted Islam on the spot, and somebody was after him trying to kill him. But still the Prophet ﷺ had a goal and he had a mission, and he was always making da'wah to Muslims and non-Muslims. What about the Sahaba? Well, if you are from India or Pakistan, or if you are Kurdish or Arab or Turkish, or from Europe, Spain, if you are from Africa, Somalia, North Africa, you are a Muslim most likely because your parents, grandparents accepted Islam because of the Sahaba. They conveyed Islam to them. They didn't force them to accept Islam. And some of the Sahaba, they lost their lives doing so. They left their families behind. They sacrificed their time, their life, and money just to give us Islam. And as I said, a lot of Muslims even don't appreciate this. They don't honor the sacrifices of the Sahaba, and they don't even pray or practice Islam. Even young Sahaba, little kids, like the brothers and sisters in the back, they have ulu al-himma. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was passing in the street one day, and he saw Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he was probably 7 years old in that neighborhood. He was very young. So Abdullah ibn Abbas, Umar radiallahu anhu, saw him sitting by himself, and he was thinking and something, and he said, why are you not playing with the kids? Go play with them. He said, well, I play sometimes, but I have not been created to play. So he said, why have you been created? He said, to give izzah to Islam. لُعِزَّ الْإِسْلَامِ. And that was very deep, man. So his mission in life as a kid, 7 years old, was to give izzah, dignity and honor to Islam. So that was his purpose and mission. If you look at the scholars of Islam, some of them, they would travel thousands of miles just to get one hadith or one mas'ala, one ruling in fiqh. You read about Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Bukhari. They would travel from Iraq to Medina, or from Iraq or Medina to Egypt, and vice versa, to get one hadith from Rasulullah. Now, if you have an iPhone or a Galaxy S3, or you have access to computer, iPad, iPhone, you have access to encyclopedias about Islam, and a lot of Muslims, they don't even know how to make wudu properly. Why? Because the more advanced technologically we become, the more lazy we are. Okay? But these Sahaba, they did it the hard way, so they appreciate it. Now we do it the easy way, so it doesn't mean anything to us. If you look at Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, one of the biggest scholars of Islam, he said, wallahi, I have written 2,000 books with these two fingers. Only two fingers. 2,000 volumes, 2,000 books of knowledge for the Muslims. If you look at someone like Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah, the great Khalifa, he said, إِنَّ لِي نَفْسًا تَوَّاقًا تَاقَتْ نَفْسِي إِلَى الْإِمَارَةَ فَلَمَّا نِلْتُهَا تَاقَتْ إِلَى الْخِلَافَةَ فَلَمَّا نِلْتُهَا تَاقَتْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةَ. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah says, I have a very ambitious soul, very ambitious. So I've always wanted to become a governor, a ruler. So when I became a governor, I wanted to become a khalifa. So I became a khalifa. Now I want to go to Jannah. So he always has a goal in life. So what about you? Every one of us should have a goal in life. What do you call a student who stays in grade 3 for 5 years? So for 5 years, he is in grade 3. I don't know about you, but I personally would call him an idiot. Okay? So what about us? What about me? If I'm now what I was 5 years ago, if I'm still reciting Surah Qul Huwallahu Ahad, because this is the only surah I know in the Quran, and I did the same thing 5 years ago. So while I'm still typing, if I have access to computers, if I'm still typing 5 words per minute, okay, or I'm still making mistakes in wudu or salah, or I'm still not able to recite Quran properly. And I'm not talking only about non-Muslims. A lot of Muslim brothers from Arab countries, they don't know how to recite Fatiha. I teach Tajweed, I know, and people make horrible mistakes in Tajweed, even Arab, in Fatiha, and Qul Huwallahu Ahad. And I keep telling them, this is why imams die young, heart attacks and stuff, because people are not learning, people are not progressing in life. So you have to set a goal for yourself and you try to achieve it. If you are now what you were 5 or 10 years ago, then you're not progressing. You don't have adequate him. I'm going to conclude with this story. This story changed my life. And this is one of the most inspiring stories you will hear in your whole life. So for the next 3-4 minutes, if you usually fall asleep in the khutbah or you mess with your phone, please pay attention and listen carefully. This is a very important story. It might change your life just like it did to my life. This is the story of Muhammad ibn Abi Amir. He used to live in Spain, Al-Andalus, a little bit over 1300 years ago. His job was a hammar. Hammar basically means someone who transports stuff on the back of a donkey for a petty cash. Like, you transport something from your house to your store, and you give the guy like a dollar or two. So that was on the back of a donkey. So that was his job. So one day, he had two friends, and they sat together after Isha. They had a good meal, biryani or something, and good tea. And they started to think about the future. They were young. Muhammad ibn Abi Amir was like 15, 16 years old in that neighborhood. So he said to his friends, do you guys have a goal in life, something you try to achieve in the future? So one of them said, yes, I now have one donkey, so maybe inshallah in 10 years I'm going to have 5 donkeys. So instead of making $1 a day, I'm going to be making $10 a day. The other one said, look at this guy, he doesn't have any goal in life, just 10 donkeys for me. I want to have 20 donkeys. So instead of making 10 bucks a day, I'm going to be making 20. So this is my biggest goal in life. Then they said, you Muhammad ibn Abi Amir, what's your goal in life? He says, my goal in life is to become a Khalifa of Muslims in Al-Andalus. So they said, la hawla, this guy is high. He lost his mind, okay? He's been working all day in the sun. He lost his mind. First of all, you are not from Bani Umayyah. That was the ruling family at the time, the monarchy in Andalus. And number two, look at your job, man. You're not a teacher, you're not a doctor, you're nothing. You're not a plumber, nothing. You're just hammar. You transport stuff on the back of your dog. What is this? Hopeless case. So he says, well, let's assume hypothetically that I become an imam, a khalifa one day for the Muslims in Andalus. What do you guys want from me when I become khalifa? So the first one said, well, it's impossible, but let's assume for the sake of argument you ever become the Khalifa of the Muslims in Al-Andalus, then I want 100,000 golden pieces, dinar from you, a huge palace and a big garden. So I said, okay, good. What about the second one? The second one, he says, well, it's impossible, man, it's impossible. Elephants can fly, but you can never become Khalifa. If you ever become Khalifa, spit on my face, put in a donkey backwards and send kids, school kids behind me to throw me with, to belt me with rotten eggs and tomatoes and say, himarun ala himar, a donkey on the back of a donkey. He said, good, alhamdulillah. First thing in the morning, Muhammad ibn Abi Amir sold his donkey. He sold it. And he applied for a job as a police officer, so he became an RCMP. In 30 years, he was promoted until he became the chief of the police and the leader of the army in Al-Andalus. The same year, Al-Khalifa Al-Muntasir died. His oldest son was 10 years old, Hisham. He was always playing, he was always gambling, hanging out with girls, so he was no good. His mother said, let's get someone, a guardian, wasi, for Khilafah to run the Khilafah in Al-Andalus until my son grows older and he's able to shoulder the responsibility of Khilafah, because otherwise the Spanish people, the Portuguese, are going to kick us out, Muslims. So the best one they got, and she said, we cannot get someone from Bani Umayyah, like the kid's uncle or something, because he's going to slaughter him and take over Khilafah. What we can do, we can get someone reliable from outside the Bani Umayyah family. So who did they get for the job? Muhammad ibn Abi Amr. So for a couple of years he was Khalifa. He was taking care of Khilafah, he was running the Khilafah, and he realized that this guy, Hisham, was no good. He's always playing, he's not thinking about becoming a Khalifa, nothing. So he said, well, okay, take this basketball and go play. Now I'm the Khalifa. And he actually assumed Khilafah, he became the Khalifa, officially. Then he remembered his two old friends. He sent his guards to the market and they brought them back. This is 30 years later and each of them still had one donkey. Just one. So he brought them to the palace and he said, you guys remember me? Yes, they said, yeah, yeah, you're our old friend. How can we forget you? So he said to the first one, what did you ask of me 30 years ago? He said, well, I always expected a brilliant future for you. You know that, right? I don't have to tell you. Yeah, what I asked of you was the palace and the 100,000 golden dinars and the garden. He said, take it, go home. The second one, he said, what did you ask of me 30 years ago? He said, well, I don't remember you. He said, you just said 2 minutes ago you remembered me. You're too young for amnesia. You see, what did you ask of me 30 years ago? He said, well, I'm too busy. My wife is going to shoot me if I'm late for dinner. He said, no. I'm going to beat you up if you don't tell me. I'm going to give you a nice beating, like New York style. So tell me. So he said, yes, I admit. I said, if you ever become Khalifa, put me on the back of the donkey, backwards, send kids to belt me with rotten eggs and tomatoes. So this is the punishment. So he said, Wallahi, I'm going to do this to you. حَتَّى تَعْلَمَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا يَشَاءُ قَدِيرٌ. So you know that I'm not unjust, but so that you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. When you were making fun of me 30 years ago, you're not actually making fun of me, you're making fun of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His power and strength. نَسَى اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى أَنْ يُعَلِّمَنَا مَا يَنْفَعُنَا وَأَنْ يَنْفَعُنَا مَا عَلَّمَنَا سَأَلُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله ربه رحمة للعالمين. I'm not sure if you have seen this pamphlet before. I got the job as an imam in St. Catharines about 6 months ago. A few days before I arrived in the city as an imam, a Somali sister was leaving the masjid and she was attacked and beaten up by three white teenage girls. Okay, it was all over the news back then, 6 months ago. So I spoke to the brothers in the masjid and I said, we have to do something. Ulu al-Himma. These people, these girls, they did it because they didn't know anything about Islam. There are not a lot of Muslims in the Niagara region, maybe 3,000, 5,000, not many. So Muslims here are not visible like they are in Toronto or London, Ontario or Edmonton or Vancouver. We don't have a lot of Muslims here. And these people, the only thing they know about Islam is what they get from Fox News, the Sun paper and all these things, so they are messed up. They don't know anything about Islam. So what we need to do is teach them about what Islam teaches. Plus, a lot of people, they are not happy with what they have, the religions they have. They are desperate to find something else. So what we are doing now is to give them a better alternative. So inshallah, this pamphlet, we started sending it to homes like 3-4 days ago. 120 or a little bit over 120,000 homes in the Niagara region. Every single home in the Niagara region will get this pamphlet. We're talking about Niagara Falls, St. Catharines, Niagara-on-the-Lake, Welland, Thorold, Grimsby, and other places. 120,000 people. This is the largest da'wah project in the history of Ontario. Almost 500,000 people will get this pamphlet. It talks about what Islam is and what Islam is not. What people need to do about Islam, about jihad, and about hijab, and about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all these beautiful things about Islam. We did the same thing 2 years ago, actually a year and a half ago in Alberta. That this pamphlet was mailed to 1 million homes in Alberta. Every single home in Alberta received this pamphlet. Alhamdulillah, we got a very positive feedback. A lot of people came to the masjid for tours, and some people actually took shahada after they received this. So what we want you to do, inshallah, whatever you can donate. There are some brothers and sisters in the back with boxes. Whatever you can donate, inshallah, this will help us tremendously. We are short 7,000. And if we get the 7,000, inshallah, today, we'll complete the project. Every single home will give this project, inshallah. I spoke to the youth and the children our Saturday school. And one of them came to me with $3. And he said, well, I'm ashamed because I only have $3 in my pocket. And I said, when you give us $1, this will help us to send this pamphlet to 5 homes. If you give us $3, this will help us send it to 15 homes. 15 homes, this means around 40 or 50 people will get access to this pamphlet. So whatever you give, even if it's very little, it would take us a long way. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us sincerity in everything we say and do. and to guide people to Islam, and to forgive our sins and to accept our good deeds, to give us the best in dunya and the best in akhirah. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yaghfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina. Allahumma aslih ahwalana wa aslih azwajana wa aslih awladana. Allahumma aghfir li abaina wa ummahatina wa liman 'allamana wa ashabi al-huquq 'alaina. اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا الا غفرته ولا هما الا فرجته ولا مريضا الا شفيته. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give victory to our brothers and sisters throughout the world who are being abused and to forgive all Muslims. Ameen. Ameen. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين واقم الصلاه.